can't be here today. So just be aware that it is recording. And if you want to turn your camera off, that's fine. Although it's lovely to see your faces. I'm going to mute all your microphones to avoid feedback. And if you haven't been muted, could you mute yourself as well? And I would recommend that you use the speaker view setting so that you make the best and get the best of the speakers more. And I would encourage you to make use of the chat facility to interact with us. If you want to leave some thoughts or a message of remembrance, we will capture these messages and keep them. And if you've been affected by this or any other attack and want to speak to someone, the contact numbers for the casework team will be displayed at various points. And caseworkers Will Roberts and Claire North are in the group amongst us. And if you want to speak to them, send them a direct message and they'll respond. So in a moment, I'm going to introduce Colin to say a few words. But first, I'm just explaining the order of events for this afternoon. We're going to hear Colin speak, and then hopefully, if he can get onto the call, Councillor Mike Hannon, who's been a huge part of the story of Warrington's recovery and part of the journey of the Peace Foundation from its earliest days. I'm then going to ask you to join us in a few minutes of reflection while we listen to some more music and see some more pictures. And this will lead into a minute's silence, which will be followed by a blessing by Afthar Kayum, who is representing all of the faith communities in Warrington. And then I will ask the worshipful, the Mayor of Borough of Warrington, Councillor Maureen Cregan, to speak on behalf of the borough. This will be followed by the laying of a single daffodil at the Peace Tree in the Peace Centre Garden, one for each of you taking part today. We will attempt to share this with you, but quite frankly, the technology may defeat us. But we will make pictures of this available on social media afterwards. And then Colin will make some closing remarks, and this will bring the proceedings to an end. So this time last year, arrangements were complete to mark the 27th anniversary of the Bridge Street and at the Peace Centre in the way we've become accustomed to. And it felt like an enormous decision to cancel the event at the last minute when lockdown was announced. And who would have believed that we'd still be in lockdown a year later? This time last year, the future of the Foundation's service for victims and survivors was in doubt. Funding from the Ministry of Justice was coming to an end, and no decisions had been made about our future. This time last year, we had to be innovative. Emergency COVID-19 funding from the Steve Morgan Foundation enabled us to continue supporting victims of terrorism. The now closed Peace Centre was repurposed to provide accommodation for NHS workers and, with Warrington Youth Club, to provide childcare for their children. Those team members who weren't furloughed were working from home, and Zoom became a routine way to communicate. Now we have a new normal, new technology that enabled us to continue our work in communities in innovative ways. Furloughed team members are back, schools are open, and our work with young people is back on track. And since October, we've been funded by the Home Office Victims of Terrorism Unit to provide a brand new peer-to-peer service for victims and survivors of terrorism. The Foundation's casework team have supported 175 victims of terrorism over this time. And by the end of March, we'll have put on 11 events, providing information and training for victims. And we delivered training to numerous primary school teachers in Greater Merseyside and Warrington on trauma-informed practice and self-care regarding the pandemic. Our work, funded by the Northern Ireland Victims Survivors Service for those living in GB affected by the Troubles, has continued uninterrupted, but with the benefit of new ways of working. Next year is not certain, and we face many challenges as we emerge from the pandemic, but we have reason for cautious optimism. I'm now going to hand you over to Colin Parry. You have to unmute yourself.
Unmute.
Can you hear now?
No. I can hear you now, Colin. That's fine.
Can you?
Yeah.
We don't really get this technology, you know. It's. I need a loud hailer. Lots of faces looking back at me, and I'm not going to say hello to you all individually, but if I might just say hello to one or two in particular.
Colin, sorry, I've muted you. That's my fault. Unmute yourself again.
Can you hear me now? Wave to me if you can hear me. Right. Lost all my spontaneity now. I've got to do it all again. Good morning. Thank you for joining us this morning on this very important day. As I was saying, I can see lots of faces, and I'm not going to name you all because it would be silly, but I'd like to point out just a few. Particular, lovely to see Abby with us this morning, our beautiful daughter. And I'd like to say a particular hello to Rosemary Clark, who you may be able to see. Rosie and I go back to university a long, long time ago, many, many years ago, and we've been friends ever since. And thanks for joining us, Rosie. And also to Pat and Pete Taylor, our good friends, who've now moved out of the area because they couldn't stand us. They now live down in somewhere like Somerset or Gloucestershire, I can't remember, somewhere down south anyway. All right, enough of all that. Can I begin by saying, starting with the old saying, you never know what's around the corner. And on this day, March 19th, 1993, I could never, ever have foreseen how our family life would change forever, just 24 hours later. And as I remember so well, March 20th was a day rather like today that began with bright sunshine. And it was also a bright and happy Tim that went into town that morning to buy the Everton goalkeeping shorts. Now, I'm going to, for those who've never heard the story before, I'm just going to tell you the background story to why he wanted those shorts, because it sort of captures Tim in a real way. He, like everybody in the family, forgive me, Kira, was a mad blue. And Tim had never, ever entertained the notion of being a goalkeeper because he wanted to be centre forward for the team and score the goals. But just weeks before the bombing, Tim was rushed into hospital to have an emergency appendectomy. I think that's what they call it. He'd really become very, very ill very suddenly, and it was quite worrying. And off to hospital he went, and a couple of days later, of course, after they'd removed the offending organ, he was allowed home again. But his mother, Wendy, who was there to collect him, was told in no uncertain terms he was not allowed to play any sports. Absolutely not. Now, a couple of weeks in to that ban on sports activity, he came up with a smart and clever idea to con his mother. And he said, actually, the school team needed a goalkeeper. And the goalkeepers don't do much. They just walk across the line, bend down now and again, and pick the ball out of the net. So it wasn't really strenuous, and it wasn't really playing sport. So having conned his mother, he then ended up playing in goal for the school team. And as luck would have it, or it could be bad luck would have it, he saved the last minute penalty, and the team secured an honourable draw with whoever it was they were playing. And of course, it was having been in goalkeeper just that once that made him decide he wanted to go and buy Neville Southall's football shorts. Now, the young ones amongst us may not even remember who Neville Southall was, but he was a fabulous Welsh goalkeeper who played for Everton for many, many years. So that was the background as to why he went into town that morning. But of course, as we all know, he went out but never came back. And as each anniversary year passes, I grow older, but Tim doesn't. I mean, time stopped for Tim in 1993, and he is forever the eternal 12-year-old smiling boy. Now, the pain of loss subsides, obviously, as time goes by, but the sense of loss never does. But Tim and Johnathan Ball have become symbols for peace. Their names and their faces are enshrined in the Peace Foundation that Wendy and I set up in their memory, and in the Peace Centre, which also carries their names. So, Terry, I'll pause at that point, and obviously you've asked me to finish the service, so you can come back to me later, but they're my opening remarks, everybody, and thank you for listening. Oh, and good.
I'm sorry, Colin, you've been cut off again. That wasn't me that time. I don't know what happened there. At this point, I was going to invite Councillor Mike Hannan to speak. He's struggling to get in unless he's here. So we can move on. So what we're going to do now is we're going to have a few moments reflection with some more music and some different pictures. And that is going to lead into a minute's silence. If Mike is able to join us after that, we can introduce him later on. So if you just bear with me while I change the screen. Oh. Okay. Nick needs to allow me to share screen now because he's taken over as the host. So I'm just allowing Nick to do that. Great. You'll forgive me, sorry for the dead air. Technology, isn't it wonderful? Okay. If you'll forgive me, ladies and gentlemen. Okay. Apologies for that.
Down and oh my soul, so weary when troubles come and my heart burned and bleed, then I am standing with you in the silence until you come and sit a while. Try.
So thank you, everybody. I'm now going to ask us to observe 1 minute silence to remember those affected by 1993. Thank you, Afkar.
Thank you, Terry. Terry has mentioned, my name is Iftikhar. Amongst one of my roles is the General Secretary of the Interfaith Organisation in Warrington, which is well known, referred to as the Warrington Council of Faiths. Today, we once again remember one of the most tragic days in Warrington's history. A day I remember as though it was yesterday. Personally, it was a day where I experienced extreme emotions of high and low. To continue with the football theme, I didn't know Colin was going to talk about football, but that morning I travelled to my beloved Liverpool to watch them play Spurs. But whilst I had taken this journey many times before, today was different. I was fortunate enough to be invited into the executive box with past players and all the hospitality that goes with it. We actually won the match, but soon after the final whistle, that became irrelevant. As after the match, we made our way back to the hospitality boxes, my attention was drawn to the TV monitors where news flashes were being broadcast. I still remember my emotions at that time. It was as though time stood still. I froze on the spot, my heart sank. My friends who had accompanied me basically had to shake me out of my trance. The reason being, it occurred to me that my wife and my siblings were going into town that day, as most families do on a Saturday afternoon. By the grace of God, they were safe. But as we now know, there were many others who sadly and tragically were not so fortunate, including our beloved sons of Warrington, Johnathan and Timothy. We remember them today, and I'm sure the family and kin remember them not just today and each other day with affection. In our tradition of Islam, such events of remembrance and a commemoration are usually marked by readings of the Quran. The first chapter of the Quran is referred to as Surah Al-Fatiha, and is made up of 7 verses and is a prayer which basically in summary calls upon God's guidance, the master of all worlds, the giver and provider of mercy to all. I will now recite the short prayer in their memory. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Maliki Yawm al-Din. Iyaka na'budu wa Iyaka nasta'in. Ihdina sirat al-mustaqim. صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. Thank you, Terry.
Thank you very much for that, Afkar. I will now ask the worshipful the Mayor of the Borough of Warrington, Councillor Maureen Cregan, to speak on behalf of the Borough. Can you unmute yourself?
Myself now. Thank you very much. Thank you. Hello, everybody. I'm honoured to be here today as Mayor of Warrington, albeit online due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Do apologise. I would like to begin by extending a very warm welcome to all of you who are both near and far, as joined us here today to commemorate this significant anniversary. This time of year is always difficult for those who lost loved ones, were injured or affected by the event because of someone they knew were in town centre on that fateful day. I was born and raised in Warrington, as were my children and grandchildren. And I'm incredibly proud to say that Warrington is truly part of who I am. And I can remember where I was on that day at that time, and I will never forget. 20 years on, it is important to reflect and to remember. We will never forget what happened in March 1993, but we must continue with hope for the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Madam Mayor. I'd now like to invite Councillor Mike Hannan, if he's able to join us, just to say a few words. And if not, no, okay. What I'm gonna do now, it's the travails of modern technology, unfortunately. We have to deal with this a lot of the time now. Our colleague and friend Claire is currently at the Peace Centre, at the Peace Tree in the garden, and she is going to lay daffodils for everybody, one for everybody here. This would normally be something we'd all do together, but I'm going to ask Claire just to symbolically lay daffodils for everybody at the Peace Centre. Thank you, Claire. I did count them, honestly. Thank you very much, Claire. Now, before I hand back over to Colin to bring proceedings to a close, I would like to thank all the speakers today. I would also like to give special thanks to the Reverend Stephen Kingsnorth for many of the photographs you've seen today. Stephen's been part of this story from the beginning and has spoken at every anniversary until his recent retirement. And actually, it's one of the positives of the pandemic that technology has advanced, which allows Stephen to be with us today, as well as friends from as far away as Tasmania. I want to thank also our Chief Executive, Nick Taylor, and the entire Peace Foundation team, from housekeeping, maintenance and admin, to our amazing programme workers and facilitators. And a very special thank you to my team, Will Roberts, Claire North, Laura Greenwood and Vicky Brown, for everything they do every day for victims and survivors of terrorism. And finally, thank you to all of you for taking part and making this event a thing. I'll now hand over to Colin to bid you farewell and to bring proceedings to a close. Thank you, Colin.
Am I live? Yes?
Yes.
Okay.
You were.
Well, thanks, everybody, for the contributions you made. It seems unusual, Stephen, not having a slot here, Stephen. I think you must have lost your mind. Stephen and I have had a very happy talk-about relationship for many years, and he's a thoroughly nice man, but I do like to pull his leg a little. So there's no food today, I'm afraid, Stephen. our friend here, the minister, mentioned the fact that he'd been at a Liverpool. Did you say Liverpool match against Spurs? I think you did. Yeah, one of those minor themes. Anyway, funny thing is that it was also that same Saturday that Ireland, the rugby union Ireland, beat England in what was then, maybe it's the Five Nations. I'm not sure if it was the Five Nations or the Six Nations. But I remember the Irish celebrations were considerable to beat, you know, the old enemy. But of course, Ireland, to its great credit, experienced the grief of Warrington as we did, because they just were conscious of the fact it was two young boys that had lost their lives. These weren't soldiers, they weren't police officers. Not that their deaths would be any more justified than children's deaths, but of course, for two unknown children in a northern town that had no strategic importance, military importance, to be killed in that terrible way was a shock to the island of Ireland. Needless to say, we're very proud of the fact that the boys, Tim and Johnathan, are part of the very fabric of this proud town now. A town which I like to think is synonymous with not just the word peace, but more importantly, the practice of peace. The Foundation's unique contribution to peace is testament to the hard work of so many good people in this town over the past 28 years. But as everybody engaged in the Foundation's work knows only too well, no matter how important our work is, the harsh reality is that we must continue to evolve if we are to meet whatever the future brings our way. And as I said at the start, you just never know what's around the corner. So I thank you all for marking this anniversary with us in these extraordinary times. And I hope that next year we'll meet in person again, but this time on Bridge Street. I'd like to thank Terry for all his hard work in putting this service together. It's not easy. I couldn't have done it. I can barely make a telephone call these days, never mind handle all this modern technology. And our thoughts are with Nick Taylor as well, who very sadly lost his father just a matter of days ago. Nick, for those of you who may not know, is the Foundation's chief exec. So our family life goes on, but there will always be a spare seat at our table, and Tim is never far from us. And here are a few lines that I discovered this morning, which mean a lot to me. And I quote them, "Look at the stars, how they shine and glow. Yet some of those stars died long ago. Still they shine in the evening skies, and love like starlight never dies." So with Tim in our hearts, and also of course remembering Wilf and Marie Ball, who both have died some time ago, the parents of Johnathan, and if I might say so, and I know Harriet is with us, although I can't see Harriet in front of me at the moment, Harriet's mother Bronwyn, was a victim, we believe, of the Warrington bombing as well. She lost her leg as a result of the bombing, and roughly a year later, she lost her life. So we always remember Bronwyn too, and Harriet, our thoughts are with you today as well. So unless I'm getting the hurry up signal from you, Terry, which I think I probably am, Again, thanks to everybody. It's been a really appreciated that this was put together to get us around these lockdown days. I hope the lockdown days end very soon and we can all meet up again. But thanks once more and enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you.
Thank you.
Goodbye from the Beatles as well.